From Pacifica, this is Democracy Now!
We are not here to lecture. We are not here to tell other people how to live, what to do, who to be, or how to worship. Instead, we are here to offer partnership based on shared interests and values to pursue a better future for all of us.
As President Trump vows not to let human rights concerns interfere with U.S. relations with Saudi Arabia, the country is set to execute 14 men, including Mujtaba Aswiket, who was only 17 when he was sentenced to death 5 years ago. He planned to visit and attend Western Michigan University, but was detained by Saudi airport authorities for allegedly attending a pro-democracy rally earlier that same year. We'll speak with Maya Foa, director of Reprieve, and Randy Weingarten, president of the American Federation of Teachers, who are speaking out against the execution. We'll also speak with Weingarten about billionaire Education Secretary Betsy DeVos, who has said she considers education an industry and called the public school system a dead end. Then to Arizona, where a hearing is underway that will decide whether a ban on ethnic studies in Tucson schools is unconstitutional.
In our determination, we found that these classes were promoting ethnic resentment. They were promoting ethnic solidarity in ways that are really intolerable in an educational environment.
Then tobacco, a deadly business. From Vice President Pence to Health and Human Services Secretary Tom Price, a new Guardian report exposes how tobacco companies have gained unprecedented influence in Washington under Trump.
The amount of lobbying that tobacco companies are doing doesn't necessarily correspond with the amount of influence they have with the Trump administration and in Washington, D.C., and in fact across the world, especially in places like Africa, where developing nations are trying to implement health regulations to stop people from smoking and to save lives.
We'll speak with Guardian reporter Jessica Glenza. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The U.S.-led war against ISIS has reportedly killed at least a dozen civilians every single day since President Trump took office 6 months ago. That's according to a new investigation by the journalistic monitoring group Air Wars, which says since President Trump took office, U.S.-led coalition airstrikes and shelling in Iraq and Syria have reportedly killed more than 2,200 civilians, a far higher rate of reported civilian casualties than under the Obama administration. The investigation comes as the U.S.-led coalition continues to launch dozens of airstrikes a day against the Syrian city of Raqqa, where tens of thousands of residents are trapped without access to water or electricity. Over the weekend, the latest round of U.N.-backed peace talks about the Syrian war ended in Geneva without any plans to resolve the ongoing conflict. In Saudi Arabia, 14 men accused of taking part in protests are reportedly facing imminent execution. The group includes Munir al-Adam, who is half-deaf and partially blind, and Mujtaba al-Swekat, who was only 17 when he was sentenced to death 5 years ago. In 2012, he was arrested at the airport in Saudi Arabia while en route to visit Western Michigan University, where he was later accepted. He's now facing execution for allegedly attending a pro-democracy rally in 2012. After President Trump's visit earlier this year, a Saudi criminal court upheld several death sentences handed down to the protesters. We'll have more on the Saudi executions after headlines. Back in the United States on Capitol Hill, Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell has delayed a vote on the revised Republican health care bill, as Arizona Republican Senator John McCain is unable to vote while he's home recovering from surgery to remove a blood clot above his left eye. The Congressional Budget Office has not yet finished its review of the Republicans' latest health care bill, unveiled Thursday. But it's similar to the previous bill, which would have caused 22 million Americans to lose their health insurance over the next 10 years. Over the weekend, Republican governors confronted Vice President Mike Pence and Health and Human Services Secretary Tom Price over the health care plan during a closed-door session at the National Governors Association conference. The Trump administration is continuing to face criticism and scrutiny over revelations that Trump's own son, Donald Trump Jr., embraced an apparent effort by the Russian government to peddle information incriminating Hillary Clinton in an attempt to help Trump win the presidency. Over the weekend, new information surfaced showing as many as 8 people were in the room during Trump Jr.'s meeting with the Kremlin-linked lawyer, Natalia Veselnitskaya. Among them were Trump's son-in-law, Jared Kushner, then campaign manager Paul Manafort, a Russian-American lobbyist named Renat Akhmetshin, publicist Rob Goldstone, who helped set up the meeting, and at least one translator, as well as a representative for the Russian family who asked for the meeting. On Sunday, President Trump's lawyer attempted to blame the Secret Service for allowing the participants into Trump Tower for the meeting, causing the Secret Service to issue a rare statement saying Donald Trump Jr. was not under Secret Service protection at the time, and, quote, thus we would not have screened anyone he was meeting with at that time, unquote. Top Democrats continue to call the meeting evidence of collusion between the Trump campaign and Russia. This is California Democratic Congressman Adam Schiff speaking to Jonathan Karl on ABC's This Week on Sunday.
Well, you know, it's certainly tied in the sense that this is about as clear evidence you could find of intent by the campaign to collude with the Russians, to get useful information from the Russians.
A willingness to accept, we see, from the president's son. But we don't see anything—
More than that, though, a willingness not only to accept, but to indicate to Russia what the best timing was.
The Trump administration also faced criticism from Fox News host Shepard Smith on Friday over Donald Trump Jr.'s meeting.
If there's nothing there, and that's what they tell us there's nothing to this and nothing came of it, there's a nothing burger, it wasn't even memorable, didn't write it down, didn't tell you about it because it wasn't anything, so I didn't even remember it with a Russian interpreter in the room at Trump Tower. If all of that, why all these lies? Why is it lie after lie after lie?
That was Shepard Smith of Fox News. On Sunday, President Trump attacked the media and Hillary Clinton and defended his son, writing, quote, Hillary Clinton can illegally get the questions to the debate and delete 33,000 emails, but my son Don is being scorned by the fake news media, unquote. And, quote, with all of its phony, unnamed sources and highly slanted and even fraudulent reporting, fake news is distorting democracy in our country, unquote. Trump faced protests while attending the United States Women's Open Saturday, which was held at the Trump National Golf Club in Bedminster, New Jersey. More than 100,000 people had signed on to a petition calling on the LPGA to move the venue. On Saturday, activists gathered outside the venue to protest Trump and his history of making sexist comments and bragging about sexual assault. President Trump's approval rating has now plummeted to a mere 36% as he nears the 6-month mark of his presidency. It's the lowest 6-month approval rating of a U.S. president in 70 years. The Washington Post ABC News poll also showed only 24% of people support the Republicans' plan to repeal and replace the Affordable Care Act. Meanwhile, the White House has declared this week Made in America Week. Despite the fact that Trump's own companies outsource the vast majority of manufacturing to factories overseas, Trump's daughter Ivanka Trump exclusively outsources the manufacturing of her clothing and accessory lines to overseas factories, mostly in Bangladesh, Indonesia, and China. Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan is asking the Turkish parliament to extend the state of emergency for another 3 months. Over the weekend, the president commemorated the first anniversary of the failed military coup and vowed to continue the brutal crackdown against activists, journalists, teachers and opposition lawmakers. He also called for the reinstatement of the death penalty in Turkey. In the Dominican Republic, tens of thousands of protesters flooded the streets of the capital, Santo Domingo, Sunday to demand the resignation of the president and top officials currently embroiled in a corruption scandal. Many of the protesters dressed in green to show support for the environmental justice movement. Solidarity marches were also held Sunday in New York, Miami, and Madrid, Spain. In Venezuela, millions of people took part in an unofficial referendum called for by the opposition. The opposition says the referendum showed disapproval for Maduro's plans to form a new constituent assembly, which critics say is an effort for Maduro to consolidate power. At least one woman was shot in the capital, Caracas, while waiting to vote in Sunday's referendum. To see our recent debate about the ongoing protests in Venezuela, you can go to democracynow.org. In Puerto Rico, recently freed political prisoner Oscar Rivera has joined the fight against the dumping of toxic coal ash in Penuelas, calling on fellow Puerto Ricans to join the growing civil disobedience protests. In recent days, hundreds of police have raided and dismantled a resistance camp near the dumping site, arresting longtime community leaders, many of whom are senior citizens. Coal ash is a highly toxic mix of arsenic, mercury, lead and other heavy metals, which can contaminate nearby by air and drinking water, causing cancer, lung disease, developmental delays, birth defects and impaired bone growth. Again, Oscar Lopez Rivera has joined those protests. In Arizona, court hearings continue in a case that will decide whether a ban on ethnic studies in Tucson public schools is unconstitutional. In 2010, Arizona passed a controversial law banning the teaching of any class designed for a particular ethnic group that would, quote, promote resentment toward a race or class of people, unquote. The law ended up eliminating Tucson's ethnic studies program and banning 7 books from public school classrooms, including Rethinking Columbus, The Next 500 Years, Shakespeare's play The Tempest, Pedagogy of the Oppressed by Paulo Freire, and Chicano, The History of the Mexican Civil Rights Movement. We'll go to Arizona for more on the trial over the ban on ethnic studies later in the broadcast. Hundreds of protesters rallied outside the headquarters of the National Rifle Association in Virginia Friday and then marched 18 miles to the Justice Department to protest against the NRA. The march was led by the organizers of the Women's March in Washington, D.C. after Trump's inauguration. This is Sarah Dachos of the group Moms Demand Action for Gun Sense in America.
As a mother, I have a son, and I would like him to grow up in a world where he feels safe walking down the street to go to the playground, that when he goes to school, he doesn't have to do lockdown drills, because we now live in a climate where somebody who is not safe with a gun has access to guns and can go into a school and shoot children.
And groundbreaking Iranian mathematician Mariam Mirzakhani has died. A professor at Stanford University, she is the only woman and only Iranian to have ever won mathematics' highest award, the Fields Medal. She died Saturday at the age of 40 from breast cancer. Multiple Iranian newspapers broke social taboos by publishing photos of Mirzakhani without a hijab after Iranian President Hassan Rouhani posted a picture of her on Instagram without her head covered. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman.
And I'm Juan Gonzalez. Welcome to all of our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world. We begin today's show in Saudi Arabia, where 14 men accused of taking part in protests are reportedly facing imminent execution. The group includes Munir al-Adam, who is half-deaf and partially blind, and Mujtaba al-Suikat, who was only 17 when he was sentenced to death 5 years ago in 2012. Mujtaba had planned to visit Western Michigan University, where he had applied for admission, but was detained by airport authorities in Saudi Arabia for allegedly attending a pro-democracy rally earlier the same year. He was accepted by the university as a student in 2013. But was not able to attend following President Trump's visit earlier this year. A Saudi criminal court upheld several death sentences handed down to protesters. During Trump's visit to Saudi Arabia in May, his first trip abroad as president, he suggested human rights concerns would not interfere with U.S.-Saudi relations.
We are not here to lecture. We are not here to tell other people how to live, what to do, who to be, or how to worship. Instead, we are here to offer partnership based on shared interests and values to pursue a better future for all of us.
Saudi Arabia has one of the highest execution rates in the world. Human rights organizations say prisoners are often tortured into making false confessions and convicted in secret trials. Rights groups have urged the Trump administration to use its ties to the kingdom to prevent further abuses and stay the executions. To talk more about the death penalty in Saudi Arabia and the possible execution of these 14 men, we're joined by two guests. In London, Maya Foa is with us, director of the international legal charity Reprieve. And here in New York, we're joined by Randy Weingarten, president of the American Federation of Teachers. We welcome you both to Democracy Now! Let's begin with Maya Foa in London. Talk about who these men are and why you believe that their execution is imminent.
Well, these 14 men, thank you, these 14 men, many of them very young, some of them under 18 when they were arrested by Saudi forces, are all alleged to have been involved in protest-related offenses. Now, to give you a couple of examples of what that means, we had another case of a young man called Ali al-Nimr, who was facing imminent execution last year. He's still in danger. He's not among the 14, but his his charge sheet explained that among the offenses that had rendered him, that had made him death eligible, were inviting people to the protest on his BlackBerry, administering first aid on his BlackBerry, not on his BlackBerry, administering first aid to protesters at the protest. There were offenses in the case of, that you mentioned, Mushtaba. He was accused of attending the protest and inviting others to the protest. These are clearly not offenses that we would deem, that we wouldn't deem them offenses at all, let alone worthy of sentencing people to death. Mushtaba al-Swaykat, who you mentioned in the intro, was 17 years old when he was allegedly at this protest. He had a future in America. He had been admitted to two colleges, two universities had given him placements, and he was actually due to travel over to the U.S. He was in the airport on his way there to go and look at the two campuses and decide where he wanted to go. When he was arrested by Saudi forces, he was brutally tortured, so much so that they broke his shoulder, they denied him first aid, and of course, the torture was intended to get him to confess to this so-called crime of attending the protest.
And Maya...
He gave a confession after torture, which is not admissible under international law or Saudi's own law. He was later sentenced to death, and now he and 13 others are looked to be executed at any moment if the international community
is not able to intervene and call on the kingdom to halt these executions. Maya, I wanted to ask you a report that you issued recently. Maya, a report that you that your organization issued recently says that as many as 40% of the people executed in Saudi Arabia are executed for nonviolent offenses like participating in protests.
That's absolutely right. We've seen a massive uptick in executions and death sentences for nonviolent protest offenses. It looks very much to us like an attempt to quell any kind of dissent, any kind of free speech, freedom of expression, freedom of assembly are being entirely eradicated in Saudi Arabia. On the 2nd of January last year, there were 47 people executed in a mass execution on one day. Among those were numerous so-called protesters and a couple of juveniles as well, at least six of them. One of them, Ali al-Rib, was dragged out of school by the police. He was then, again, brutally tortured, forced to confess, and then executed without anybody knowing, so that his family only found out about the execution of their son after the execution itself, from newspaper reports. To date, they still haven't been told where his body is. They never got to see it, never got to give him a burial. They don't know where he was buried or even how he was executed. And that young man, that child, was executed for apparently attending a protest.
And Randy Weingarten, the AFT weighing in on this issue, the importance and why your union is involved in this issue?
So, Maya, so first off, Reprieve is our heroes. And Maya got to one of our staffers over the weekend. In fact, we represent—we're the largest higher education union in the United States. And as you know, Juan, you know, with what we did in terms of students at Rutgers who are documented and fighting for them, we have this reputation now of making sure that we fight for our students and have multinational, multi-ethnic universities. And so Reprieve got in touch with our locals out in, first in the University of Michigan, because we thought that he was going to the University of Michigan, and then we found out later it was Western Michigan. We represent grad students, adjuncts, professors, and we just on Saturday just went into motion and tried to figure out how to engage, I know that's kind of funny with the Trump administration, ironic, but how to engage the State Department, Department of Defense, Department of Homeland Security, and do it in every way we could in terms of shining the light. Because if we don't do that, and as Maya said, what happens is all this gets done in absolute secrecy, all to intentionally to suppress freedom of speech. And so our union is on it, and we have try to find ways to make sure that the Saudi government knows that the American government is watching this and is fighting this. And that's what we're trying to do in every way we can. Obviously, this is a suppression of speech. These are our values. These should be values internationally. And equally, if not more important, how does anyone, how does any country be in the community of countries and behead people? And ultimately, I would say, if anybody in Saudi Arabia is watching, how do you fight terrorism? How do you fight ISIS? How do you fight all of this if you are beheading people? And so there is a moral issue here, as well as just us wanting to fight for this child. This child, he's 17. When he got into university, he was 17 years old. He has been in jail, and what Reprieve has found, because historically, because of what they know, is that the moment that people are moved to Riyadh, the moment that people are moved to the capital, then we don't know if their beheading is imminent or their death is imminent.
So, Maya Foa, what are you calling for now? And, Randy Weingarten, have you reached anyone in the Trump administration, since they have close ties to Saudi Arabia?
Yes. We actually, between the senators and us, we actually reach people. We're, and, Maya, you know, we are trying to see if we can get someone to visit this youngster. So we are, you know, we did actually reach people over the weekend. But as I said, Maya and Reprieve are—we're working very closely with them.
Maya, what you're calling for now and the indications to you that the execution is imminent with the removal of the men and specifically Mujtaba from the prison to Riyadh, which is a sign of imminent execution.
Mm-hmm. That's absolutely right. We are extremely concerned about Mujtaba and the 13 other men, young men, who are now potentially facing imminent beheading and execution. We are calling on the international community to raise these cases, to raise them with the new prince in Saudi Arabia, to raise them with the American government. All of Saudi Arabia's allies need to be saying that it is not acceptable to be beheading and killing children, killing people who have simply—their only crime is to have attended a protest, to have expressed a view about democracy, to have exercised their democratic right to free speech, that it is not acceptable to quell dissent in this way and to carry out these executions in secret without informing the family in a manner that the UN has said is tantamount to torture. We need to hear from the allies. Donald Trump, at the head of this program, you'd quoted him saying that we share values. Well, I would very much hope that the execution of children for attending protests, the execution of disabled people, people who have been disabled through torture they have received at the hands of the Saudi authorities, that American values are not in killing those people, that America still stands for democracy, for freedom of speech, for freedom of assembly, and that we do not support the executions, the unlawful executions of children, of peaceful protesters, of vulnerable people like disabled Munir al-Adam. And I would hope that we can all call on the Saudi authorities to halt these imminent executions of these 14 individuals immediately and give them a permanent stay of execution.
Maya Foa, I want to thank you for being with us, director of Reprieve, speaking to us from London. And Randy Weingarten, we'd like to ask you to stay with us after break. We want to talk to you about your assessment of the DeVos administration. That's Betsy DeVos, the Secretary of Education. Randy Weingarten, president of the American Federation of Teachers. Stay with us. Whisper by Donny Marie. I am Snow Angel and Claire London. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.
We turn now to look at billionaire Education Secretary Betsy DeVos, a longtime backer of charter schools and vouchers for private and religious schools. She has said she considers education a, quote, industry and called the public school system a dead end. A recent study by Stanford University Center for Research on Education Outcomes, however, found that students attending for-profit charter schools have significantly lower academic gains than those attending nonprofit charters.
DeVos is back in the news this month after she said she wanted to return the Education Department's Office of Civil Rights, quote, to its role as a neutral, impartial investigative agency, unquote. An official with the office came under fire last week after she said that most campus rape claims amount to two young people who are both drunk. Meanwhile, attorney generals in 18 states and the District of Columbia are suing DeVos and the Department of Education over a rule to protect student loan borrowers that was set to go into effect July 1st, until DeVos announced a reset of the rule known as Borrower Defense to Repayment. To discuss all this and more, we're joined by Randy Weingarten, president of the American Federation of Teachers. It's good to have you with us. Can you assess, starting with today in the latest news, what's happening in the Department of Education?
Yes. It's a disaster. I mean, it's—so what we said—so we spent a lot of time, as we just talked about before, in Michigan. And we watched Betsy DeVos when she was an advocate for privatization and charters and for busting up public schools in Michigan. And we said she was the most anti-education secretary who had ever gotten that position. And I think everything she's done since then has proven that. So this is what she's doing. Number one, it's not just promoting for-profit charters and vouchers. But it's also taking a meat axe to the federal budget that goes to vulnerable kids, both in education and in health care. That's number one. That's part of the budget. Number two, she's cutting the enforcement. And number three, probably more important than anything, even though I think the budget cuts are really important, is that an agency that is supposed to be about equity, that is supposed to fight for the vulnerable— She is squarely on the side of lenders instead of borrowers, and you see that with the borrower defense rule you just talked about. She's squarely on the side of, you know, of the powerful and not the vulnerable. So she stripped away the transgender rules, the stuff that's going on with campus violence and campus rape, and what Candace Jackson said, saying essentially, even though she apologized, that, you know, 90% of these cases are because somebody's drunk. And now the entity that is supposed to be there to protect against discrimination, protect and ensure that people have a shot at education, she's saying is now going to be neutral.
And Randy, the importance of her hiring as one of her deputy assistant secretaries, Adam Kissel, who comes out of the Koch Foundation, for higher education.
Well, this is what—this is—it's not just the fox guarding the hen house. This is an active undermining of the equity and discrimination rules that were embedded since Johnson in terms of the Department of Education. So it's cutting the money for public schools. It's preferring lenders over and for-profit colleges over students. And now it is actively undermining what OCR, the Office of Civil Rights, is supposed to do for the vulnerable. Let me add one more thing, because the health care bill comes into this as well.
Yeah, I'm going to ask you about that. Yes.
78% of school districts in America use Medicaid. 78%. So if you take the health care bill, that basically takes a huge whack out of Medicare, ends Medicare as we know it, that then hugely hurts every child in these 78% of districts, wheelchairs, feeding tubes, the screening, and these kinds of things. So this is taking a whack out of the most vulnerable, taking away funding from those from people who are poor who need opportunity, like after-school programs and things like that. And then on top of it, basically not just undermining the enforcement, but basically saying we are no longer going to be the agency that makes sure that there's no discrimination for America's school children.
Explain this latest news on OCR, the Office of Civil Rights. Explain the implications of this.
So what since from the moment, from all of the civil rights laws back to the 1960s, one of them was the education law. There was public access, there was voting, there was education. And what was created was the Office of Civil Rights. And so there was a presumption that that office was going to fight against discrimination and fight for equity. This was not just something that Barack Obama did. This goes back to every president, Republican and Democrat alike. And so when she says she's going to make that agency neutral, she is taking a step away from the enforcement of civil rights laws.
Neutral between the perpetrators of discrimination and the victims of discrimination.
How do you make a law that where, you know, people—look, I represent a union. I represent people. I believe people should have due process. And I believe there are false accusations. But frankly, as a survivor, as a rape survivor, how do you not create some kind of climate to actually help people tell their stories and get redress? And it's not just on, you know, it's not just in terms of Title IX, but it's every other law. I mean, think about what happened after Brown versus Board of Education. Think about how the so-called choice movement was used by segregationists to stop people from having, stop black and brown kids from having opportunity. So the OCR, that entity, is the one that people go to in order to enforce discrimination rules.
And what alternative is there at the state level to be able to beat back some of these things that are happening now at the level of the Federal Department of Education?
Look, the great thing is that 18, you know, we went to the attorney generals. It is fantastic that the attorney generals, 18 or 21 of them, are now, you know, suing to enforce the borrower defense law or regulation. I mean, what it essentially means, let me just, because those are code words, what it essentially means is that Corinthian College went bankrupt. All these kids were left holding the bag with their student debts. What the borrower defense law means, or rule means, is that just like Corinthian gets its debts discharged in bankruptcy, these kids should not be holding the bag. That's what it means. So the AGs are suing on that. And look, we thankfully, we were able, in a bipartisan way, to get the new federal law covering K-12 passed last year in the Congress. And even Lamar Alexander just said to Betsy DeVos, you're misreading the law.
I wanted to ask you about, well, the NPR is reporting Wayne Johnson will be the new head of Office of Federal Student Aid after James Renzi abruptly resigned last month.
Right. This
is according to the Department of Education. FSA is an agency responsible for administering $1.4 trillion in outstanding student loans from 42 million borrowers, plus aid programs for millions of college students. As not mentioned in the department's press release and first reported by BuzzFeed, Johnson is currently the CEO of Reunion Financial Services Corporation, a private student loan company.
Right. I mean, this is—I don't think saying the fox guarding the hen house is enough to describe what is going on. You basically have people from an industry that bilked kids, that have, you know, have had predatory practices, now running the student aid programs. And it's just, it is this preference, this out-and-out preference for the lenders, for the for-profit colleges that we have fought for the last several years. Like, you can't give worthless degrees and leave kids holding the bag with unsustainable debt. And basically, we are winding back the clock on this as well as on rights.
Well, Randy Weingarten, I want to thank you very much for being with us, President of the American Federation of Teachers, as we move on to other education news. Juan?
Well, we turn now to Arizona, where a hearing is underway that will decide whether a ban on ethnic studies, which eliminated the Mexican-American studies program in Tucson schools, is unconstitutional. In 2010, Arizona passed a controversial law banning the teaching of any class designed for a particular ethnic group that would, quote, promote resentment toward a race or class of people, unquote. Following the passage of the bill, then-Arizona Superintendent of Public Instruction John Huppenthal ruled in 2011 that the Mexican-American Studies program violated the state law, despite an independent auditor's finding that showed otherwise. This is Huppenthal speaking on Democracy Now! In January 2012.
In our determination, we found that these classes were promoting ethnic resentment. They were promoting ethnic solidarity in ways that are really intolerable in an educational environment.
The Tucson Unified School District ultimately suspended the acclaimed Mexican-American Studies program in 2012 under the threat of losing up to $14 million of funding if they allowed it to continue. The program's suspension also included banning 7 books that can no longer be used in the classrooms, including Rethinking Columbus, The Next 500 Years, Shakespeare's play The Tempest, Pedagogy of the Oppressed by Paulo Freire, and Chicano, The History of the Mexican Civil Rights Movement. For more, we go to Tucson, Arizona, where we're joined by Richard Martinez, as one of the attorneys representing the families challenging the Arizona law. Welcome back to Democracy Now! We spoke to you when you were bringing this case. You're in court now. What's happening, Richard Martinez?
Well, thank you for the invitation. And today we start the second week of the trial, which is expected to last through probably at least Tuesday of next week. And this is a trial to Judge Tashima, who's a sitting, by designation, Ninth Circuit judge. And in this case, we are challenged the constitutionality of the statute and the enforcement of the statute under the Equal Protection Clause and under the First Amendment.
And Richard Martinez, part of your argument, as I understand it, is that you're trying to prove that the law was racially and politically partisan in motivation. And you're presenting evidence about the involvement of Dolores Huerta, the famous leader of the farm workers union, and how that triggered the decision by some. That she was speaking in Arizona, that triggered the decision by some of the officials involved here to begin work on this law. Can you talk about that for people who are not aware of the background to how this law came into being?
Sure. The Mexican-American Studies program had existed for about a decade in the Tucson Unified School District. In 2006, during the Cesar Chavez Celebration Week, Ms. Huerta was at Tucson High School, gave a speech to the student body, and during that speech, she made reference to the fact that, from her perspective, Republicans hated Latinos. And she was questioning, you know, why had they come to that position? And during that period, there was, as exists now, a significant amount of anti-immigrant, anti-Mexican sentiment in Arizona. Tom Horn, who's then superintendent of education, hears that comment or hears about that comment, reacts very negatively, insists that his deputy have the opportunity to speak to the student body at Tucson High School. That was Margaret Garcia Dugan. Several weeks later, she addresses the student body at the high school. She does not provide any opportunity for the students to ask questions of her. So the students in protest placed tape over their mouth and turned their backs on her during her speech. This further enrages Mr. Horn, who then embarks on a sustained effort to have the Mexican-American Studies program banned. And ultimately, in 2010, as a companion legislation to SB 1070, he's successful that year, and Jan Brewer signs HB 2281. Before leaving office and prior to the statute being in effect, he issues a violation finding with respect to the program. Mr. Huppenthal takes office within days, adopts that finding, and then hires, subsequent to that, an independent group to investigate called Cambion. Cambion conducted an on-site investigation and audit of the Mexican-American Studies program, found the program to be fully compliant, in fact, recommended that the program be expanded within the school district. Mr. Huppenthal rejected that finding, issued his own finding, which essentially mirrored that of Mr. Horn, and ultimately in January of 2012, the school board was forced, they were compelled to ban the program.
So can you talk about what's happening in court right now and the significance of this case, not only for Arizona, but for the country?
Well, this court, you know, this challenge to the statute has significance in different ways. You know, the equal protection challenge focuses on the issue of the motivations of these state actors, both the legislature and their role in enacting this statute, with respect to the racial motivations. With respect to probably the more novel and important aspect of the case is the First Amendment claims. And there we're challenging the motivations, again, of these state actors with respect to not only their racial motives, but their partisan and their political viewpoints. So essentially it's a viewpoint discrimination claim against the prohibition from the state of disallowing these viewpoints. And the Mexican-American Studies curriculum was innovative. It was cutting edge. It was based on very solid research, and it was found to be, you know, having significant progress with the students who were attending. We were closing the achievement gap in Tucson, Arizona, for Mexican-American Studies. We were graduating more students. We were taking students at risk and keeping them in school and helping them develop academic identities. So it was significant in terms of not only what the program was accomplishing, but the state's then reaction to shutting it down. And so if successful, and certainly we come into this litigation very positive about the potential outcome, then I believe that it will be significant in terms of the precedent set that the states cannot act in the manner which occurred here in Arizona.
And the importance in terms of Arizona, of changing demographics of Arizona, increasingly a Latino and Native American state, and yet these centers of reaction continuing to try to hold back the growing population there?
Yeah, you know, certainly Arizona is one of those battleground states where, you know, demographics are in conflict. This is a state that has a significant Mexican-American population, Latino population. It's a segment of the community that is predicted to be over 50%, you know, by the middle of this century, if not sooner. And it's certainly part of the both national and local efforts to try and curb or hold that back. You know, so we've had such characters as, you know, Joe Arpaio, Russell Pierce, and, you know, certainly within that group of individuals, that kind of leadership from the right, you know, you have Tom Horn and John Huppenthal.
Well, Richard Martinez, we want to thank you for being with us, attorney representing the families challenging the Arizona law that resulted in the closing of Mexican-American Studies program in Tucson High School. We'll continue to follow what comes out of court. This is Democracy Now! When we come back, tobacco, a deadly business. What is its role in the Trump administration? Stay with us. We'll be right back. Whispers in the Deep by South Africa's Stamela. Member Ray Justnow-Fiori passed away last week at the age of 70. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.
We end today's show with a stunning new investigation by The Guardian that reveals how tobacco companies have gained unprecedented influence in Washington since the Trump administration came to power. The Guardian reports politicians with deep ties to the tobacco industry now head the U.S. Health Department, the top attorney's office, and the Senate, even as tobacco use remains the leading preventable cause of death. Vice President Mike Pence has reportedly received $39,000 in donations from tobacco giants R.J. Reynolds and more than $60,000 from the tobacco company-aligned National Association of Convenience Stores, both among his top donors. Trump's nominee for Solicitor General, Noel Francisco, reportedly represented both R.J. Reynolds and its parent company, Reynolds American, Inc., and Secretary of Health and Human Services Tom Price reportedly owned at least $37,000 in shares in Philip Morris International and Altria.
The Guardian series also looks at how U.S. and British tobacco giants are trying to expand their global market, especially across Africa. According to The Guardian, British American Tobacco, or BAT, and others have resorted to legal intimidation when Uganda and Kenya attempted to pass health warnings and regulations on tobacco products sold within their countries. This is a clip from a video accompanying The Guardian report.
Tobacco is a deadly business. Cigarettes kill half of those who smoke. But this is not a story of an industry in decline. The tobacco industry is thriving. There are now an estimated 77 million smokers in Africa, and those numbers are predicted to soar. But African governments are not standing by. Many are bringing in regulations like those that have saved millions of lives in the West. BAT and other multinational tobacco firms don't seem to like that. And they're fighting in the courts.
Meanwhile, Reuters recently obtained documents revealing Philip Morris's campaign to subvert the world's anti-smoking treaty. Reuters reviewed internal emails in which Philip Morris executives took credit for watering down anti-smoking measures at the biennial meeting of the Tobacco Control Treaty. All this comes as a proposed $49 billion merger between Reynolds and British American Tobacco is currently underway. Well, we're joined right now by Jessica Glenz, a health journalist for The Guardian, the lead reporters on this new series, Tobacco, a Deadly Business. Jessica, welcome to Democracy Now!
Thank you for having me.
Talk about the tobacco industry and its connections to the Trump administration and members of the cabinet.
Sure. So I think I always like to start off with something that really surprised me, which was the amount of lobbying that's going on in D.C. and how the numbers, the dollar figures, don't actually reflect the influence that these companies have. As a lot of people may know, there isn't as much lobbying in D.C. by tobacco companies as there used to be. That's reduced. But it'd be unfair to say that the amount of influence has reduced. As some people may know, Mike Pence, for example, infamously said in 2001 that smoking doesn't kill. He also, as you mentioned, received—
What do you mean he said it doesn't kill?
He literally said that smoking doesn't kill. He put out a press release that said smoking, quote, doesn't kill.
Well, let's go more into that. In 2001, Pence writing, quote, time for a quick reality check. Despite the hysteria from the political class and the media, smoking doesn't kill. A government big enough to go after smokers is big enough to go after you, he wrote. So you got that 2001 email in which tobacco lobbyists discuss donating to Pence, the email saying, in part, after my meeting with Mike Pence, I'd recommend that we cut him a check in the near future.
Right.
Talk
that,
about this.
That email was sent 2 months after the press release that you just referenced. So Mike Pence says smoking doesn't kill, and 2 months later, tobacco lobbyists say, we budgeted $3,000 to give to Mike Pence, and I think that we should cut him a check for $2,000 right now. We've already given him $500. So they're talking about what increments of cash do they give Mike Pence for his support of, or his perceived support of, the tobacco industry. He also owned, as part of a family business, a chain of 210 convenience stores called Tobacco Road. And he's not the only person in the administration who has these kind of ties. The health secretary, Tom Price, also has similar ties, As you mentioned, he owned $37,000 worth of tobacco stock. He earned a similar amount in donations from tobacco companies, and he voted against important laws that were passed in 2009 that increased the price of cigarettes and that provided regulatory oversight to the FDA for tobacco products. That 62-cent tobacco tax hike, by the way, was to pay for health care for impoverished children. So Tom Price voted against it, saying that a 62-cent tobacco tax hike was a blow to working families. Meanwhile, that money went straight to pay for impoverished children.
But I wanted to ask you, because your series focuses a lot on the growth area of tobacco in the world, which is obviously the third world. And increasingly, as American companies have increasingly had their sales from the third world, polluting industries have increasingly moved to the third world. Talk about tobacco's role in Africa and in the developing world.
Sure. So, as you mentioned in the lead-up, tobacco companies and predominantly the big five tobacco companies, but here we're sort of focusing on Philip Morris International and British American Tobacco, have created a campaign to try to push regulation of this treaty in a way that's favorable for them. As you mentioned, the Reuters investigation found that Philip Morris International had created a campaign to get administration of this treaty push toward finance and tax ministers and away from health ministers, people who might be more interested in getting these kind of health regulations put in place. Our investigation found that in Africa, tobacco companies and aligned associations were sending letters to governments saying, we noticed that you proposed this set of smoking regulations, and by the way, we think it contravenes your constitution, and we think it could be against world trade treaties. So it follows a pattern that tobacco companies have set out over many, many years of trying to delay implementation of life-saving regulation.
So let's talk about this. According to your report, Africa had the lowest number of tobacco deaths among World Health Organization regions in 2010. The World Health Organization predicts nearly half the population of Congo-Brazzaville will smoke by 2025, and smoking rates will increase in 17 other countries. Mm-hmm. You also look at Kenya as a case study.
Mm-hmm. Right. In Kenya, the Supreme Court is hearing right now arguments between the tobacco company and the government. The government wants to pass a set of anti-tobacco regulations. Tobacco companies are fighting that. And the reason that's important is because, especially in developing nations, you have a limited budget in which to fight these kinds of fights, in which to get these sorts of regulations enacted. So it's a very closely watched case on the continent. Other governments are watching it. And if, for example, the Kenyan government failed, it could act as a deterrent for other governments to enact these sort of regulations because they know that it will be pricey and potentially it won't pay off. It won't protect their citizens the way that it is intended to.
So, in other words, the regulations that we here in the United States take for granted, like warning signs on packs of tobacco or restrictions against selling to minors, these are the kinds of things that tobacco companies are doing here, but while they are fighting in every one of these other countries?
Well, I would argue they're fighting it here as well. Mm-hmm. So it was interesting what you said at the beginning is that, you know, how are they sort of increasing their hold on developing nations? And I think that the broader answer is they're increasing their hold on impoverished populations here in the United States and in developing countries. So to me, one of the best examples is West Virginia. Now, everybody knows that smoking is the number one leading preventable cause of death, right? It's something that we say a lot and we've heard over many decades. But I think that It's the figures that really are shocking. So if you only have a GED, a high school equivalency degree, you're almost 10 times more likely to smoke than someone who has a graduate degree. Same goes for someone who makes less money, people who live in rural areas. And why I bring up West Virginia is because, as we all talk about the opioid epidemic on a regular basis, many people know that West Virginia is the heart of that epidemic. So the way public health officials measure impacts on populations is through a rate per 100,000, right? So 41 people overdose for every 100,000 who live in West Virginia every year. That's how they measure that rate. Now, if you look at a southwestern county in West Virginia, an impoverished place, lung and throat cancer alone kill 123 people per 100,000. That's triple the rate of the opioid epidemic.
I want to go back to the members of the Trump administration. Can you talk about Noel Francisco, the nominee to be the Solicitor General of the U.S. in the Trump administration, reportedly represented both R.J. Reynolds and its parent company, Reynolds American, Inc.?
Sure. Noel Francisco was a very high-profile partner at Jones Day, the same law firm that represented the Trump campaign. So Noel Francisco has been nominated for Solicitor General, the top attorney in the United States. Noel Francisco also represented R.J. Reynolds in a challenge to the Federal Drug Administration's graphic warnings on cigarette packs. So any American who's been to the convenience store in the last couple days will know that it's still the same U.S. Surgeon General warning on every pack of cigarettes, which is sort of amazing given that every other Western nation has graphic warnings now. We don't in the United States, and part of the reason for that hang-up is because Noel Francisco successfully argued in an appeals court that the graphic warnings proposed by the Food and Drug Administration shouldn't have a quit line on them, 1-800-QUIT-NOW. The reason that he argued that is because he said, well, that amounts to government advocacy, and we're not going to put that on our pack of cigarettes. And ever since then, the FDA has been saying, well, we're at the drawing board coming up with a new graphic warning system. That still hasn't happened several years later, and public health advocates are now suing the FDA to force their hand. So that's something that we're going to look for the outcome of.
I want to ask you about Tom Price. In January, Health and Human Services nominee Tom Price was questioned by Minnesota Senator Al Franken about his tobacco stock holdings. This is a clip of what he said.
How do you square reaping personal financial gain from the sales of an addictive product that kills millions of Americans every decade with also voting against measures to reduce the death toll inflicted by tobacco?
Well, it's an interesting question, Senator, and it's a curious observation. I have no idea what stocks I held in the 90s or the 2000s or even now. All of these decisions for all of us, I suspect, are through mutual funds and through pension plans. I would bet, I ought not bet here. I would suspect that in your pension plan, that there are components of that that are held that may have something to do in some time in your history with tobacco. So,
I find it very hard to believe that you did not know that you had tobacco stocks.
Your response to Price's equivocation on the question.
Well, I've always thought that was a bit of a bizarre answer from Tom Price, especially given that he talks about how his father was a lucky—I don't know if that played in the clip—but how his father was a lucky strike smoker and his father was killed by those cigarettes. So, to me, I mean, Tom Price's record speaks for itself. He voted against a 62-cent tobacco tax hike. He voted against giving the authority to the FDA to regulate cigarettes. And at the same time, he called that a blow to working families. And that is difficult to reckon if you actually want to control tobacco use.
And we have less than a minute, but the FDA commissioner, Scott Gottlieb.
Sure. Scott Gottlieb started his career at an investment bank where he's helped raise money for an e-cigarette company called Cure, Cure with a K. And he also, in some editorials when he was working as a pundit, said that he thought e-cigarettes might be a good alternative to smokers. And that is something that is really up for debate, and the research is still coming in on that. So Scott Gottlieb is now in charge of those e-cigarette regulations, and we'll have to wait and see what he does to further or hinder them.
And how does the Trump administration compare to the Obama administration?
Well, the Obama administration signed the 2009 law to give Food and Drug Administration the authority to regulate tobacco. So I would say that to this point, there have been absolutely no legislative wins for health advocates from the Trump administration.
Well, we want to thank you for being with us. Jessica Glenza, health reporter for The Guardian, will link to your series, Tobacco, a Deadly Business. And that does it for our show. Democracy Now! Produced by Mike Burke, Dina Guzder, Nermeen Sheikh, Carla Wills, Laura Gottesdiener, Sam Alkoff, John Hamilton, Robbie Karen, Hani Masood, Trina Ndura, Andre Lewis. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.